countries realized that this virus was coming. They were seeing other countries being hit along the way. But frankly, very few, if any, countries were prepared for COVID-19.
She had a fever of about 100.
Woke up with backaches nearly a week ago.
I completely lost my sense of smell.
Like CDC, the state and local and territory health departments are underfunded.
I'm getting flooded with calls that have flu-like illnesses. What's filling in that gap?
The CDC is reformulating portions of test kits that were flawed.
We're months into this pandemic, and we're still hearing about testing problems.
Anybody that needs a test.
This virus ain't that serious.
Messing up with my spring break.
They're there. They have the test.
This morning, the party is over.
It seems we are only at the beginning of what could be a very long period of restriction. But how long is this likely to take?
It's something that I think when history looks back on it, it'll be comparable to what we saw in 1918.
Labs are backlogged and some testing sites are short on supplies.
They need help here. Cities cannot handle COVID just on their own.
With COVID-19, we were seeing what was going on in China, and then Europe and Japan. Here in Washoe County, things just changed dramatically.
Breaking news, there is a new presumptive positive case of COVID-19, also known as coronavirus, this time in Washoe County.
We're going to prepare, not panic.
Thursday night, Washoe County activated its level 1 emergency communications, letting the community know everyone is on standby.
Really ramped up with our response, as we also saw a huge increase that occurred with cases happening here in Washoe County.
The first instance that we heard about coronavirus was through CDC emails that we do get on a national level whenever there's a unique situation going on or an outbreak.
We did have a pandemic influenza response plan that the health district had developed. The federal government also had a pandemic influenza response plan. The problem was that the plans, both ours and the federal plan, was based upon relying on the federal government to provide us with the support that we needed to respond to the pandemic. What we got was almost a complete abdication.
We practice all the time, simulating an event where we needed to vaccinate or medicate people. We never thought we'd have to be actually doing a test, which is, it's a lot more invasive. You have to have a skill level more to do the type of testing we're doing, and just more thought to go into the process.
We had to improvise and develop our own plans as we moved through the response.
At that point in time, it was mostly conversations around the office about when do we think this will hit? What do we think it'll look like?
We were sitting around our conference table, and by we, it's myself and two other epidemiologists, and that was our team.
Nobody had ever done anything like this before. Nobody in our lifetimes has experienced a pandemic like this.
We did hear back from CDC. They confirmed that our first presumptive positive case, a male in his 50s that was off of the Grand Princess cruise ship.
21 people on board tested positive for the virus, 2,400 passengers and 1,100 crew members. So far, only 46 have been tested.
The Grand Princess today finally slipping under the Golden Gate Bridge and into San Francisco's harbor.
We had Washoe County citizens that were on the Grand Princess cruise ship. That was an individual and his family that had traveled from San Francisco down to Mexico, and then it had disembarked when they came back up to San Francisco before they really knew that there was an outbreak that was occurring on that ship.
I was home and I got the call. I was told, be there tomorrow at 6 a.m. We have a lot of planning to do.
On March 5th, this gentleman, he received an email from Princess Cruise Line. They notified all of the states, anyone who was on that first leg of that cruise ship. And sure enough, he had been feeling sick since he'd left the cruise. We tested him and he was our first case.
From there, it was 6:30, 7 in the morning until 8 to 10 o'clock at night for many of the staff.
We were in a room upstairs, just a small whiteboard. We drew out our first post.
We essentially took the divisions, dumped them all out on the table, and just put people in positions that would work.
The next day, we determined that there may have been an exposure loosely linked through his grandchild, who was attending kindergarten class.
The Huffaker Elementary School. There was an influenza-like illness outbreak that was occurring in the classroom that one of those students was in. And so we had to shut down that school and have a plan for testing the students to determine whether it was flu or COVID-19. And the process for the sample collection was with a nasopharyngeal swab at that point.
18 or so kindergarten students were invited to be coming through and getting tested.
We began that over at our TB clinic, where we had some space to be able to do that sample collection. It was flu, we identified that. Wasn't COVID in the school, but we, from there, had a plan in place for how to test people. And that evolved into the post that we're operating now, where we can get 150 or more people an hour through there for testing.
I don't think they had any idea at that point, or neither did I, how big it was going to be.
It was so chaotic, working as hard and as fast as they could to try to accomplish things and get the systems in place.
We knew it was a massive undertaking. The health district really stepped in and manifested the role for what we as an entire group were going to be able to do for the community.
The health district staff have done an incredible job of the way they've planned for and developed the post operations over time. There's really no escape from this incident for the people that are involved in it. And I can tell you that I think it's important to recognize Heather Kerwin. She just carried us for the first month at least into this response with the work they were doing for the contact tracing. I had to sit down with her, and my board chair had to sit down with her, and we had to demand that she find a day to take off, because she was just working and working and working to keep us going. But so from that initial response of overnight developing this post program.
You're talking about a bunch of health people, some epidemiologists, some nurses.
We were super fortunate to have our health district staff step in and help us, really, because there's no way we could have done any of that by ourselves.
I think we were successful where we were able to work together with people who recognized that it's not one person that has the answer to this, but that we all need to try to put our heads together and do our best thinking to figure out how do we solve this problem. The health district staff has done an incredible job as problem solvers to look at what we need to achieve and figure out how to get there. Fortunately, the federal government has provided funds to Nevada through the PPP Act. Between that and some other emergency response funding from CDC, about $10 million to help staff that all up. We're looking at bringing a whole another 50 or so, actually more than that, people on board just to continue with what we need to do for COVID-19 until we can have the vaccine.
Throughout the COVID response, I think a lot of barriers have been broken down. The different divisions, community clinical health services, environmental health, air quality, administration, the office of the health officer, you have your certain things you do.
From this experience, I know people that I can count on and people that remain level-headed in a serious situation and people that know how to work together and support one another.
I believe that this pandemic is going to end, but this virus is not going away.
If there is risk, there must be choice.
Is 2022 the year that it is?
And it's been a completely bizarre 2 years that we've had here that nothing any of us could have predicted.
Everyone's top COVID question isn't where do you get a test or what's the new variant called? It's when is this going to end?
If you look at the deaths, those are people who unfortunately did not get vaccinated.
Well, in the early phases of something like this, you really have to be questioning yourself about how did I end up in this situation?
When really our globe is divided on so many issues, it's really hard to see something like a invisible virus bring us to a point where we're so one side or the other.
There's Pfizer, there's Moderna, there's Janssen, and there was a lot of questions, which one's better, which one's gonna give me more protection?
You know, you think about a pandemic, and oh yeah, that's something we need to be prepared to deal with, but until it's happening, you can't really comprehend it. I'd never had actually, you know, planned and had a goal of being the health officer. I was the air quality management division director when my board of health asked me to do this job. I think that that the health district and I did a good job coming through this, but it's overwhelming. I don't know if I had the decision to make again, if I would say, yeah, that's what I want to do. But I had the job, and I don't think anybody else was going to take it at that point.
It was kind of the race for vaccines. Both Moderna and Pfizer had been enrolling people all fall into their clinical trials. They were all under the FDA emergency use authorization when first released. And I believe it was just a few days before Christmas and the weeks prior, the first Pfizer vaccines were shipped.
We had to develop a procedure for how we were going to roll out the vaccine. It was difficult because you had to do a lot of planning without a lot of information.
There was a lot of kind of questions and challenges that they thought might happen with just getting that mass vaccine to all the locations. It was high stress. It was, of course, our first winter dealing with coronavirus and weren't really sure what would happen with our hospital's capacities.
We finally had a way out of this. We felt the phones were ringing off the hook and there's a great demand for getting the vaccine. The challenge that we had, though, as well, was trying to make sure that we had an equitable approach to make sure people that didn't have as easy access to the vaccine were able to get vaccinated.
Here at the health district, we actually have what's called a POD plan, so point of distribution, POD. And that plan details how we would do what's called mass prophylaxis of a community. So basically exactly what we were being asked to do, which was get as many doses of vaccine into as many people as possible in a short period of time.
I remember in the early days with how hard we worked to try to make sure that there was no wastage. You had so many doses that were available from each vial of vaccine, and we were working hard to make sure that every time we punctured a vial, we were going to get all of those shots in people's arms. And so we'd be up against the end of a day at the pod operation, figuring out how many doses we had available and finding people that we could get those administered to.
Everyone came through the pod, and I just remember it being surreal being out there and just cars lining the parking lot. It wasn't being distributed at pharmacies or anywhere else. We were it. So January, February, it was either Pfizer or Moderna, and people didn't have a choice. They couldn't say, I want Pfizer, I want Moderna. It was whatever we were giving that day is what you got. And then when Janssen came out, it was one shot, but it wasn't as effective as what people were hearing. And so they didn't want it.
Nobody could really anticipate or imagine what this was going to be like and what we would need to do. We took people from all across the health district way outside of their normal job functions or their areas of expertise, and we asked them to solve a problem.
We had, just the National Guard was out there, and pharmacists, veterinarians, retired doctors and nurses that came back and wanted to help. And we couldn't even keep up with the volunteers.
We stepped up our testing operation literally overnight with people on our end and in their personal protective equipment. And we refined that every day to work to make it better. And we did that across every aspect of what we were doing at the health district to take our best crack at it and continue to work to learn from how that was going and refine it and do a better job the next day. And everybody stuck with it. Everybody took the brunt of those waves when they were hitting us. And together they all worked to meet the needs of our community, and they did a tremendous job.
I think one of the big things for me, the learning experience, is just that, gosh, how do we get back to making things and events, gatherings, safer and healthier for everybody, so that people who are severely immune compromised, who maybe have been living a life at home for the last two straight years, can come back into our community and kind of feel like they're part of the normal social fabric once more. I think that's something that's really important that we forget about for those of us who have a normal functioning immune system. I have some really close friends who are severely immune compromised, and it's just like, how will I ever go to a concert again? Can I go sit inside at a restaurant ever again? You know, and I think social connectedness is something that's so important to human health. And we discount it a lot because it's not like something that's going to boost my own, you know, physical activity numbers. Being friends with somebody doesn't make me run a mile faster, but I think it's something that we forget about for our mental health. It's really important. And I think for different pockets of our population, they've really been isolated now and isolated for so long that they're not sure how they're going to get in there. So that's something that's definitely, that and long COVID, I think, are two big looming questions for me. But at least there's enough of a population dealing with those elements that there will be support and continued and ongoing research and hopefully scientific, you know, breakthroughs that help them get back to a place of more normalcy as well.
Mm-hmm.